Hello and welcome to Left, Right and Centre. I'm Gargi Rawat. A big political development in Kashmir with a 15-member National Conference delegation meeting detained party leaders Farooq Abdullah and Omar Abdullah. Omar Abdullah, in fact, was seen for the first time in 2 months as he was taken into custody just before the big Jammu and Kashmir announcement on the 5th of August. And on Monday, a PDP delegation will meet Mehbooba Mufti. Here's a report.
The first visuals of National Conference leaders Farooq and Omar Abdullah in a long time. Omar Abdullah seen for the first time in over 2 months, sporting a beard, taking selfies with his party MPs. Farooq Abdullah looked cheerful, standing with his wife, showing the victory sign. But the 15-member National Conference delegation that met the detained Abdullahs this morning says a political process can start only after their leaders are released.
If the political process has to start, then these people have to be released. If we have to get the people to sign the mandate has to be signed by the president of the party, Dr. Farooq Abdullah. Let them be released, and then the working committee of the party will meet. We will all meet together and discuss and formulate a strategy for the future. The National Conference will continue to strive for the welfare of the people of Jammu and Kashmir.
The NC says it cannot contest the block development elections when the entire opposition is in jail. The BDC elections are scheduled for October 24th.
Sari leadership band hai aur jitne bhi isme participants hain unko ye dena hai, instruction dena hai, instruction lena hai, wo sab ke sab band hai.
To aap kehte pehle leadership
chhuti jaye, chhut jaye aur uske baad agar hum election mein hissa le sakte hain wo to unhi ke direction pe hoga.
NC MPs say they had to wait 2 weeks to get permission to meet the Abdullahs.
We are waiting for this meeting for the last 15 days. This is part of our gesture to have a first-hand information about well-being and welfare of Omar Saab and Farooq Saab. And there is nothing beyond that.
Official sources say the government is willing to allow similar meetings with detained leaders of other opposition parties. A delegation of PDP leaders from Jammu will meet Mehbooba Mufti on Monday. The PDP leader is detained at Chesma Shahi. Besides three former CMs, Sajjad Lon, Shah Faisal and dozens of former ministers and legislators have been detained for the last 2 months.
Farooq Abdullah's residence has been declared as sub-jail after he was booked under Public Safety Act, and it is for the first time the incarcerated leader was allowed to meet a political delegation. The question is, does this mean anything in terms of government initiating a political engagement in Kashmir? The National Conference says it has to start from releasing political leadership and lifting curbs and communication blockade in the valley. In Srinagar, Nazir Masoodi for NDTV.
All right, to talk more about the situation in Kashmir, we're joined by Sarfaraz Wani, advocate, Jammu and Kashmir High Court, also someone who supports the National Conference, Salman Nizami, leader of the Congress, Vivek Reddy, a leader of the BJP. They're joining us from Bengaluru, and Anuradha Bhaseen Jamwal, executive editor of the Kashmir Times. Anuradha, I'd like to start with you. You know, today a delegation of the National Conference going to meet with the Abdullahs. We have the announcement of the Block Development Council elections later this month. You also have Ram Madhav saying that the leaders will have their freedom soon. So are we slowly but surely moving towards normalcy, or is this just a ploy, or are we just deluding ourselves?
I mean, right now I can only say we're waiting and watching what is happening. But whatever has happened in the last 2 months is not something which suits the definition of normalcy. It's been, in fact, one of the most abnormal situations in Kashmir ever. The way the entire leadership of Kashmir, the mainstream leadership of Kashmir, apart from the separatists and others, traders, lawyers, everybody who have been arrested, and you know, many of them slapped with the Public Safety Act. We haven't really even talked about what are the grounds on which they have been arrested. So it's not a very normal kind of a condition. Why were they arrested in the first place? It's a good thing that they are now being released. There could be scope for return to normal conditions, for some kind of political activity to take place, which is good for the state. But we're waiting and seeing.
Already, is it a case of, you know, things have been abnormal or removed, so far removed from normalcy for so long that even simple steps make us feel that perhaps things are changing for the better? Sarfaraz Wani, what would you say? You know, we saw Mr. Farooq Abdullah flashing that victory sign, but his party men not feeling very optimistic just now.
Well, before beginning, just a little clarification. I'm an advocate at J&K High Court. I don't have any lineage with any political party. So, firstly, starting that there is right now it's a mockery of elections in J&K, mockery of democracy in J&K, because we have the political presidents of these parties under detention under public safety laws. And others who want to challenge their detention in the courts, in the Supreme Court, in the High Court, they fear the repercussions. They fear that if they go up and challenge, they will be detained under the same laws. So, if this is a political process which has started, so it's essential for the political process to begin with that all these political leaders have to be released. Because we see the BJP in Jammu as well as in Kashmir, has started the process of the BDC elections, and the National Conference and other PDP and other Kashmir-based political parties, their political heads, their presidents are under detention. So the right to election also means right to fair opportunity to participate in elections. So we see that these parties are not getting fair opportunity to participate in elections. So this is something which has to go. Like we have to release them. We have to start a process. They are the political parties who have a structural base in J&K. They are the political parties who have the capacity to reach out. So just allowing them to meet is not enough. There has to be a process, the process of releasing them, the process of reaching out to the people, the process of reaching out to them. They have a structural base, and also the communication blackout, which has to go.
All right. Salman Nizami, some are saying that these elections that have been announced for the 24th of October, the Bloc Development Council election, that they've been conducted too fast. In fact, you already have this situation in which a lot of the panchayat leaders who were elected haven't even dared to return to their villages. They're staying in hotels in Srinagar.
See, the problem is, I will tell you very honestly, that Farooq Abdullah, a leader of the masses, Farooq Abdullah, he represents a very largest party in Kashmir. The man who raised Bharat Mata Ki Jai slogan in Delhi, and in Kashmir, he is being detained, and also PSA has been on him. So the thing is that you can hold elections in Kashmir, but how can you win the hearts of the people? You have the Kashmiris right now feel alienated from the mainstream leadership. There is nobody in Kashmir who is interested in to join the mainstream leadership. Even we in Delhi, Ghulam Nabi Azad is a national leader. He has served the Indian parliament for more than 40 years, and today he is called anti-national in Delhi. And Farooq Abdullah, whose party workers have sacrificed their lives for this nation, 5,000 party workers from Farooq Abdullah's party have sacrificed their lives for this nation, and today they are detained. Even Mehbooba Mufti is detained. Who is nationalist in Kashmir now? The question is, how can you regain the trust? How can you build up that trust which what the people feel alienated right now? You can hold elections, but the people of Kashmir, they feel alienated from the mainstream leadership. They feel alienated. You cannot win the trust. It took Congress more than 60 years to win the hearts of people. Still, Congress failed to regain the mass impact on the ground. We have only 4 or 5 MLAs from the Congress in Kashmir, and BJP is nowhere in the picture. But the thing is that how you will regain the trust, how you will rebuild the trust, it is a big, I think, a question for them.
All right, Vivek Reddy, what would your response be to that? Many are saying that if elections are held in these circumstances, it would be a sham election to hold elections for the Bloc Development Council. In fact, when the panchayat elections were held as well, while they were declared successful in Ladakh and Jammu, in Kashmir, you had many who were in fact elected unopposed. So how can you really call that a true election, and given these circumstances?
I think people will participate in this democratic process. The history of Jammu Kashmir has been that people had been prevented from participating in the election because of other forces. Now, this time we expect a change, a radical change, and we expect that people who are very enthusiastic about the democratic process will participate. This is number one. The second is, coming on the security situation and the detention of leaders like Farooq Abdullah and Mufti Saeed, I think one has to understand that this has been done with a larger interest. The larger interest being national security and the internal peace of Jammu and Kashmir. The important thing is they had to ward off the influences of terrorists, they had to ward off the influence of separatists, and they had to ensure that this Jammu and Kashmir is free from these forces. And that has been accomplished.
But you're talking about
and
the mainstream leaders, you're talking about Farooq Abdullah, Omar Abdullah, and you're saying, you know, to protect it from these forces, and you're talking about terrorists as well.
This is a very fragile situation. This is a new development. Abrogation of 370 is a very sentimental issue. It is essential that the passions are contained. It is essential that people will also understand that this transformation is for the good of Jammu and Kashmir. One of the panelists was suggesting that how do we win the hearts of people? Well, what happened till now with 370? What happened was there was terrorism, there was stone throwing, there was all sorts of atrocities being committed, outrages being committed.
But the way those things still
well,
exist, it's
would
not
win
that
the
terrorism
of things
has
aren't.
Nothing to do with
but the way it's not like
so this
that.
Was a
no, but it's not like that.
This was a path that was charted.
You know, normalcy has not returned.
This was a path that was charted.
Terrorism is there from last... Terrorism started from 19.
A larger piece in Jammu
and Kashmir. Article 370 is there from last 70 years. How can you relate terrorism with Article 370?
But did you want the continuation of terrorism?
Nobody
did you want
wants
the
terrorism
continuation
has, of terrorism,
of life
Vivek.
You were
didn't
the people who claimed that terrorism will be...
You did nothing.
No.
All right, Anuradha, go
the
ahead. You want to come in here?
You never did anything to sort it out.
Linking
till
terrorism
now.
There was no
and
terrorism in 2014. PDP, BJP, they came to power and terrorism again rise.
All right, Salman, one moment. Just let Anuradha also make her point. Yes, go ahead.
Sir,
you know, there is, I'll just add to what Salman Nizami has said,
for the people
that
of
terrorism and Article 3, you had
future.
Your say, please.
Vivek, one moment, you've made your point, let Anuradha speak. Yes, go ahead.
Article 370 yeah. and terrorism have no link. And you've just proved it by removing Article 370 and we've seen a rise in terrorism
exactly.
And these are your official figures. Infiltration has increased. There's so much fear of terrorism, of young boys picking up the guns now because there is so much of the... You've deepened the anger, the existing anger in Kashmir. That is a fact.
Right, Vivek, it's not like terrorism has been solved by this. Right now, it's a very abnormal situation. There is a clampdown.
Jammu province, which
you know,
has
so we don't know when
terrorism.
Will normalcy
nothing.
Return,
in
Vivek.
Batot, Misa, last week, two army jawans were killed in Batot region. That's not in Kashmir.
And I know the and I know the center keeps blaming that Pakistan
See,
and Pakistan will do something,
things.
But the point is that has always been the
this?
Case. So, you know, it's
None
not like we've solved it by these steps. Yes, Vivek, go ahead.
Yes. Now, all the panelists are saying so many things about terrorism having been reduced, or the stone-throwing incidents there. Well, if terrorism had reduced, then people would not take stones and throw at security forces.
Sir, nobody...
This has become so widespread that it
there
was
normalcy
the larger
60, 60
of
days
Kashmir.
Back,
Hold
there
on.
Was normalcy.
Let me just finish.
Amarnath yatris were there.
You
tourism.
Did nothing. You did nothing.
Sir,
for
we
you,
did... What
for
was
you,
the thing?
Stone throwing is normalcy.
Terrorism was on...
Situation.
Terrorism was nowhere in Kashmir. Nobody was used to throw stones in Kashmir 60 days back.
The only thing you wanted was mayhem. The only thing you wanted was confusion. That is why you were accountable for all this.
All right, but Vivek, what is the situation now?
Now
you have revocation
of
Article 370.
Terrorism was down. It was increased after the revocation of Article 370.
What sorry state of affairs had you brought Jammu and Kashmir into? Don't
there,
you feel,
Jammu and Kashmir
don't
was in
feel
peace,
feel
sir.
Vivek, whatever the situation...
There was high rise of tourism in
Kashmir.
Amarnath yatris were there.
All right, Salman, but Vivek, what is the situation now? You know, we have no clarity on when, you know, normalcy will return, when
everything was normal before revocation of Article 370. Everything. Even your government claimed that everything is normal in Kashmir.
Well, the irony is, this is a now
everybody is in panic in Kashmir.
The irony is,
people are scared to.
BJP is the same party which in parliament last time, in the last session, clearly said that things are improving, Kashmir is normal, we have improved the situation. I want to tell you what happened.
Vivek, just a moment. What happened in August? Sarkar has this question. He has a question for you.
BJP is the party which in last session spoke in parliament that things have improved. Kashmir is normal, tourism is coming, everything is normal, terrorism has reduced. Then what changed the things? I want to ask the BJP member here, what changed? You were the party, your minister came in the Lok Sabha and said, look, everything is normal, we have improved the situation. So how come it just in a night there was a security, this threat in Jammu and Kashmir? So what changed?
All right, and Vivek, you know, the simple question is, when can we expect normalcy to return? There was earlier talk about, you know, having some sort of calling corporates there and talking about development, and there's been a lot of talk of development, but how will that development reach the people, reach the state if these elections as well? We'll have to wait and see how it goes, but many are talking about how it's a sham election, that just calling the election does not mean that normalcy is returned. It's just trying to create this sense that normalcy is returning. But you have all these leaders still under arrest. We have no idea when they'll be released. Ram Madhav did say that the leaders will have their freedom soon, that they will be allowed to carry out their normal political activity.
Can I just come in?
But it has to be normal political activity. Who decides that? Yes, go ahead, Vivek.
Well, the process is evolving. As the government has taken this real measure, a transformational measure on August 5th, there is time, as from August 5th we have seen, that the process has evolved. There has been reduction of the measures that have been brought in Jammu and Kashmir. About 2,000 leaders were arrested. Now it is narrowed down to 250 leaders.
Jammu area, some of the leaders have been released.
So we find that there is freeing up. Yes, there is freeing up of the process. The political participants and stakeholders of Jammu and Kashmir are being released slowly, and we will find that this process will evolve and it will be taken to completion. This is number one. So far as development is concerned, I think the Modi government and the central government has better opportunity to develop Jammu and Kashmir and take it to a better path than what it had reached till now. What was it till now? It was a cesspool of militancy and separatism. Now that could not continue.
But this again, we haven't solved that.
Development,
sir, no, as some of the panelists have pointed out, now
it's an emotional issue. Article 370 is an emotional issue.
All development
people are not poor in Kashmir. Kashmiris are not beggars.
Development.
They don't need jobs. They don't need development. They need their identity.
I don't understand.
It's about emotional connect.
I don't understand why BJP is connecting everything with economy.
If
economy is the only reason, people in Hong Kong would never have protested.
All right, let Sarfaraz.
I don't understand why BJP is always.
People are sacrificing their lives for Asaram Bapu, who is a rape accused.
I don't understand why
we are fighting for our own rights.
Linking this problem
with economy. You people are fighting for Asaram Bapu, who is a rape accused. We people are fighting for our own identity.
Let me speak to Anuradha now. Anuradha, Vivek has spoken about the BJP's plans for Jammu and Kashmir. And he talks about how it's an evolving situation.
One moment, Salman, let me get Anuradha in here.
Vivek, they're making the argument it's an evolving situation. Steps are being taken to reduce restrictions, bring back normalcy, and that the Modi government, he claims, is well poised to bring development in the state. What would your response be to that? And before this, we had terrorism and militancy.
Of course. First of all, I would like to say that a lot of misconceptions have been peddled here. Jammu and Kashmir was not such a backward state or underdeveloped state. We had our own development model. We had our own economic model. Now, things were not working also because it has been a state in conflict for a long time. for 70 years, and for 30 years there's been militancy in the state, because of which stability and economy has suffered a little. Despite that, economic growth development indices were at par with the national average, even above that. We've had our land reforms and things like that, because of which the disparities between the socioeconomic disparities are not as stark as rest of the country. And now, even if, you know, you're trying to bring in another economic...
I'll let you speak after she finishes.
I really don't understand.
Even if we are trying to, or the government is trying to introduce another economic model in the state, the basic prerequisite is restoring normalcy. We do not find that anywhere. You need a certain kind of confidence in the public, in the political leadership of the state. The political leadership is all in jail. The public is being kept out of purview because there's an economic, there's a communication blockade. There are still restrictions on their movement. They have responded with a civil disobedience movement. If it's not stone pelting, they've taken to a new strategy. So we need to take these things into account. And if you're not going to be able to win the confidence of the people, if you're not giving freedom to the leaders of the state, and let me tell you, there's no clarity on when these leaders are going to be released.
All right, Vivek.
One person says 18 months. Another person says we'll release them one by one. Another person says we'll release them.
Right, Vivek, there does seem to be this sense that, you know, this grand announcement was made. Victory was almost proclaimed. It was almost as if we've solved Kashmir. If you listen to some of you know, the kind of statements being made and the celebrations over abrogation of Article 370, dividing it into union territories. But the fact remains, we have no clarity on when normalcy will return. And that will be the true test to see whether, you know, this step has really brought the changes that the government claims it will. Vivek.
Well, I think Anuradha has not understood the crux of the situation. Yes, Anuradha has not understood the crux of the situation. She is harping upon the release of leaders. Well, what was the biggest difficulty for Jammu and Kashmir? What was the biggest problem? The biggest problem of Jammu and Kashmir was militancy and separatism. I think this was
not
the biggest
leaders.
Challenge.
You are blurring
Sir, what nonsense you are talking about?
It had to be
free.
You are
lost.
You are
what happened
was,
hold on. Mehbooba Mufti was
you have no clue about Kashmir.
You are talking
everything
nonsense.
Everything was normal in Kashmir before the revocation of Article 370.
Now
there
are
very less incidents of stone pelting in Kashmir in last 1 year.
So long as militancy is removed, until then, I think. It is not
I'm
the question.
Grenade
attack in Anantnag.
I agree with you.
Militancy has to be removed.
And for that, the leaders will slowly be released after militancy is removed. Please,
so why don't you remove statehood from Jharkhand, where terrorists, where Naxalis are attacking the Indian CRPF people?
What has militancy to do with the release of leaders?
You have failed to tackle terrorism.
Vivek, what has militancy to do?
You have given Pakistan a chance to play.
All right, one moment, Vivek. Let me get Sarfaraz also in here.
I don't understand.
I think all of us want militancy gone from Kashmir.
And know the ground.
I don't understand.
One moment, let Sarfaraz
speak.
These
were the
hypocrites
who lived. You are just lying on the
militancy.
Well, I don't understand what has militancy to do with the release of leaders. We cannot all the time blame Pakistan for everything, right? So this is just a prank from BJP that it's an issue of why are we connecting all the time? Why are we connecting Kashmir?
And doesn't this also mean that, I mean, they're going to be under arrest, I think, for a very, very long
every
time, because I don't see the militancy gone.
Do you
in
mean
fact,
that
the people are
people
stuck
who claim
between,
that there are a bunch
you know,
of terrorists in Kashmir,
the
and now they are
and,
saying militancy is
and
on
others.
Rise.
You had the shopkeeper who tried to open his shop and
what
he was shot dead. And
what
so how
it?
Does normalcy return in such a situation? And that is the worry. That's the worry for most people in Kashmir.
See, just for a bunch of people, we cannot give collective punishment
collective
to the whole
punish.
People. Like there are 70 million people in Kashmir. We cannot punish them for 100 or 200 these rebels. So this is something which we need to understand. So saying this, it's about why are you connecting, another thing is why are you connecting all the time Kashmir issue with economy, with development? So people, why did people in Hong Kong protest? If Kashmir was a, if Kashmir is about economy, about development, so we need to understand that there is something more to it. There is a political process which has to start apart from this development prank. So we already see how BJP has, the economy is in shambles, the GDP is slowing down. So if you want to rectify the economy, first rectify at the national level and leave aside the development of J&K.
All right, we are far better. Our human development index is far better. Thank you all for joining us today. And
there is not an issue, obviously, that we can stop development.
First be sure, is it about development or is it about terrorism?
All right, we're completely out of time. Thank you all for joining us on the show, and thank you those who are watching. Goodbye.